Rhinoplasty is a surgery done to get an aesthetically appealing nose. There are so many types of rhinoplasty, be it an augmentation rhinoplasty, reduction rhinoplasty, tinplasty, or done along with other facial surgeries. So a detailed description of each type may take 1 or 2 days. So today I will give you an overview of rhinoplasty, mainly under the headings of what is rhinoplasty, what are the indications and what are the common types of rhinoplasty, and the techniques, basic techniques, then the incisions done, osteotomies, complications of rhinoplasty, and also the post-op care. Okay, so rhinoplasty, an overview of rhinoplasty. What is this rhinoplasty? Maybe everyone knows. You can tell it as plastic repair of nose to get an aesthetically appealing nose. That is important, aesthetically appealing nose. So what are the indications of this rhinoplasty? That is elaborate reduction and also augmentation. Reduction for we do for a hump nose, isn't it? If there is the nose, there is a hump like this in the nose, then we have to remove that, reduce it. Okay, so that becomes a reduction rhinoplasty. Then if it is a saddle nose, saddle, you know, the seat over a horse while riding a horse, it becomes a saddle nose. So in that case we do an augmentation rhinoplasty. So extensive or elaborate reduction and augmentation, that is one indication. And second is severe nasal trauma. Okay, so second indication for rhinoplasty is a severe nasal trauma in which there is a deformity of the nose, and also extensive revision procedures. That is revision rhinoplasty. And also another indication is congenital anomalies of the face including the nose. Okay, so congenital anomaly. So these are the basic or the broad indications for a rhinoplasty. The next important one is a preoperative aesthetic assessment. That is very important. Pre-op assessment. Actually, the understanding of the facial aesthetics is a prerequisite for planning any facial procedures. So usually we have a misconception that this perception of beauty is an acquired one. But actually it is a very hardwired or innate capacity, and it is based on some mathematical proportions of the face. And so this is a frontal view. This frontal is again divided into three halves. This is the upper one third. Then that is from the hairline up to the glabella. Okay, from hairline up to glabella. It is the upper one third. And from the glabella up to the lower border of the columella. Lower line passing through the columella comes the middle one third, and up to the chin comes the lower one third. And this lower one third is again divided into and philtrum upper lip complex, that is shorter one, and this lower lip chin complex, upper lip philtrum complex, and the lower lip chin complex, that is a wider lower two-third. So this is how we divide the frontal face into three halves, that is one-third, one-third, and one-third. Okay, and there is also vertical lines which passes through the face. We divide that into five equal divisions. This Frankfurt plane, that is while taking, you have to take so many facial photographs before planning rhinoplasty. So in the frontal view should be in the Frankfurt plane. That is important. What is this? And this Frankfurt plane is a line passing through the infraorbital rim and also the upper border. This horizontal line which passes through the infraorbital rim, and that should go through the upper border of the external auditory canal. If this one here comes the external auditory canal, it should pass through infraorbital rim and the upper border of the external auditory canal. That should be in the same horizontal plane. So the face should be kept like that in the Frankfurt plane. Then only you have to take the frontal picture. So the standard 35 mm photographs are taken, and also we have to take at least a 5 megapixel camera with the independent flash light is ideal for preoperative assessment of the of rhinoplasty. So standard 35 mm photographs with the 5 megapixel camera with an independent flashlight. So the one view is a frontal, that is in the Frankfurt plane, and you have to take one is frontal, second is lateral, the right lateral and also left lateral. Okay, so lateral view, right lateral and left lateral, basal, that is ask the patient to keep the face like this and take from here, so that you will get the picture of the lower part, area of the nose will be obtained like this. Okay, so that is basal. So you have to take 3/4 lateral view. Both right and left. This is the full lateral. But in a 3/4 lateral view, this eye, then nose and part of other eye will also come. So it will be, there will be a projection, only the 3/4 of the lateral view will be obtained. That is again to right and left. So how many photographs? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 photographs is a must for preoperative assessment. That is frontal in this Frankfurt plane, lateral view right and left, basal, and 3/4 lateral view again both right and left. And these views are considered as a gold standard in the preoperative documentation of rhinoplasty patients. And ideally, a digital imaging of these faces should be done. You can use either an Adobe Photoshop, or there is a very good software developed in USA which is an alter imaging for. Adobe Photoshop or this Alter Image Info, or there are so many other softwares available, and with this you can do a digital imaging of this facial assessment can be done. And also in the preoperative assessment, some of the aesthetic terminologies are important. We will go through that. The important aesthetic terminologies. One is nasion. Actually, it will come here, almost here, the at the junction of this internasal and frontal nasal suture line comes the nasion. That nasion happens in the skull bone. Okay, and another one is glabella. Glabella is actually an elevation where the two superciliary arches will come and join nasion. Okay, so glabella, nasion comes here, and just above that comes the glabella. Okay, and then is an intercandle width, third one. Intercandle width, everyone will be knowing that. That is a line passing through this. Intercandle width between the two medial canals, and another one is parallel dorsal line. Actually, I already told you that the frontal face is again divided into 5 areas, 1/5, and from here to here the second line comes, the next 1/5, from there through the ear, and like that here also. Okay, so again divided, the face is divided into 5 areas by this vertical line. So intercandal width comes in the middle 1/5, and there another terminology is a parallel dorsal line. All these are important when we calculate the aesthetic face, parallel dorsal line. Another one is a tip defining point. And that comes to the when this lateral crest and the medial crest of lower lateral cartilage come and meet, that is the tip defining point. And another one is base bony width, that we can calculate this base bony width by putting our taking our basal view photographs. And also this alar, width of alar, then alar flare, and also the aesthetic lines. They are also important aesthetic terminologies. And this lateral face is also important. I already told you it is the Frankfurt line passes through this infraorbital rim up to the upper border of the or the roof of the external auditory canal. And that is Frankfurt line. And when we draw a line perpendicular to this, the chin, then the upper lip, and also the forehead should lie in this perpendicular line, or it should be very near to this perpendicular line for an aesthetic face. Okay, that is draw the Frankfurt plane line first, and then draw a line at 90 degrees or bisecting this. So that should pass through the chin, upper lip, and the chin, upper lip, and the forehead. Either this forehead, chin, and upper lip should lie on this line, or it should be within 1 to 2 millimeters from this line for an aesthetic face. Okay, so all these points should be kept in mind while you do a digital assessment of the digital preoperative assessment of the face in rhinoplasty. And also the radix and dorsum aesthetics, dorsum and tip assessment, the tip aesthetic assessment, and also base aesthetic assessment. Base bony width will help you for a base aesthetic assessment. All these are important. Third most important one is accurate documentation of all these are very important in rhinoplasty. You have to document the details of counseling. You have to document, you have to get a very good informed consent. So documentation of counseling of the patient, then consenting is important, then personal audit should be there. You have to do a personal audit of the patient. The expectations of the patient, all this has to be documented. And also if there is any medico-legal requirement, that should also be documented, because these noses are very difficult to predict. You will not get the required shape change after, you may not get a required shape change after rhinoplasty. And so you should be very aware of the patient expectations. Okay, high expectations, we cannot reach up to that level. So all this should be documented, or if the predicted level is not reached, there can be problems in the postoperative period. So all the documentation is very important. Actually, we get two types of patient in our clinics. One we call it as Simon. What is that? That is a single, then immature, male patient, over expectant, and very narcissistic. Okay. That is single, immature male, over expectant, and narcissistic males. That is a very high risk patient for a rhinoplasty. Actually, they are not a good candidates for rhinoplasty. Okay, so it is better we avoid such patients if they come for a rhinoplasty. And the other group we call it as cilia. What is the cilia? That is secure, young, then listening patient. V is for verbal contact with between the patient and the doctor. Intelligent and attractive. If the patient, this type of patients are a very good candidate for your rhinoplasty. Okay, so always prefer such patients over this Simon, and these are very good candidates, and this patient selection is very important for rhinoplasty. The dictum is, if you cannot elicit a smile from your patient, don't operate. Because even after the operation, if you are not getting a smile from the patient, you will be in trouble. The next is operative sequence or the steps of surgery. So, always the preferred anesthesia is general anesthesia and with the hypotensive. General anesthesia is the preferred one. And positioning is for all nasal surgeries, that is reverse Trendelenburg with the 15 degree neck flexion. Okay, so so that what is Trendelenburg position? That is the leg up position. So reverse Trendelenburg will be slightly leg down. And also you give a 15 degree flexion of the neck, so that in this position the nasal cavity will be well visualized. Okay, and also it is a minimum head up position, so that there is a chance of a reduction in the venous condition, and theoretically there is a possibility of reduction in the bleeding also in this position. And after this, we inject local anesthetic, and the injected volume should not exceed 5 to 8 ml for a septorhinoplasty. That is important. Okay. So, injection local anesthetic should be less than 5 to 8 ml for septorhinoplasty. Usually, we give lidocaine or an ultracaine solution with 1 in 1 lakh adrenaline solution. It is most frequently used. So 2% lidocaine with 1 in 1 lakh adrenaline is most frequently used one, right? I already told you that this is an overview. So the usually done steps are as follows. One, as I already told, general anesthesia, that is hypotensive general anesthesia. After that, positioning and infiltration of local anesthetic, and then comes incision. Whether this is this, according to whether an open or a closed septorhinoplasty, that depending upon the surgeon's choice and other indication. And into the incisions we will come back later. And after incision we elevate a skin envelope. Okay, so for external rhinoplasty especially we elevate a skin envelope. So after incision, go for elevation of skin envelope. Okay, then what? Sixth one. Then we go for a exposure of the septum by a transfixation incision, right? So septal exposure. Usually we do a transfixation incision, right? Then after that, we do after exposure of the septum. Next one is creation of a symmetrical alar rim strip. But if the you are not going for an alar area for reconstruction, there is no need of this incision. And I already told this is for a general purpose which include all the areas, right? So after septal exposure, it is if indicated, next is creation of a symmetrical alar rim strip. How we do all this, that I'll explain at the time of each case discussion. Creation of a symmetrical alar rim strip. Then what? Then if there is a hump reduction, it is time for an incremental hump reduction. Okay, so 8th step. Hump reduction. Then after that we go for caudal septal excision. So after reducing the hump only, go for a caudal septal excision. That is excision, right? Okay. Then 10-12. So after caudal septal excision, it is time for septoplasty if needed. Don't think that we'll do septoplasty in all cases. Never. If there is an associated septal deviation, after caudal septal excision, we go for a septoplasty. Then comes osteotomies. And after this osteotomy, it is time for preparation of the graft. Graft preparation. That again depending upon for augmentation or any other type or spreader graft, whatever it is. Next do a graft preparation. And after graft preparation, if you want to put a spreader graft, do that. This spreader graft, prepare the spreader graft and insert the spreader graft. And after spreader graft, next one is the columella stirred and sutures. And sutures of the columella stirred area, then go for the tip closure, tip suturing. Tip area, tip plasty or tip sutures, and then after that you close it. And after closing, you can also do an alar base modification or alar support grafting, or you can put nasal split. Okay, so this one, this is a sequence of operation that is start from general anesthesia, positioning as I already told, then infiltration of local anesthetic. That is usually we put an 2% lidocaine with 1 in 1000 adrenaline, elevation of incision, elevation of skin envelope, septal exposure, then creation of a symmetrical alar rim strip, then comes an incremental hump reduction, then caudal septal excision, then go for septoplasty, osteotomy, and then graft preparation, then spreader graft insertion, and after that columella stirred and sutures, and then 15th step is a tip suturing, closure, and after closuring, if you go if you want, you can go for an alar base modification or alar rim support graft or nasal split. So coming to the types of incisions, actually this type of incisions are very important. Even if you are going for a septorhinoplasty or as for theory examination, this can be asked as short notes. So coming to the incisions, there are actually five types of incisions.